about Trump's tax plan. Washington Republicans want to lower Americans' taxes without bringing spending down, and President Donald Trump appears to be completely on board with this plan despite having complained about the same practice in the past. But this policy has a series of other unintended consequences. One of them, as the Washington Post's Wonk blog explains, is that Trump's tax plan will give China even more power over the U.S. economy, as additional treasury bonds will have to be issued for decades to come to cover for the tax cuts. Since less revenue will come in from taxpayers, the U.S. will have a gap to fill, and the government will have to make ends meet by issuing additional bonds. According to the Street Louis Federal Reserve, there are more foreign banks, corporations, and investors who hold U.S. Treasury bonds than private domestic investors. And to Trump's likely horror, over a third of the foreign investors are from China and Japan, meaning that in combination with Hong Kong, China held $1.38 trillion in bonds in September, making it the country's largest foreign creditor. To nations like China, purchasing U.S. Treasury bonds makes sense because the dollar still holds its position as the world's main reserve currency. By purchasing treasury bonds and notes, foreign investors actually help the United States government delay with the dollar's eventual collapse, as the bonds help to maintain the dollar's value even as the Federal Reserve has, until very recently, has continued to increase the money supply, bringing the overall purchasing power of the dollar down because its supply is much higher than what the market demands. This has been true ever since President Richard Nixon destroyed the dollar by bringing an end to the gold standard. With the Trump administration's support, Congress is raising the debt as they also cut revenue, read, taxation, and the necessity to press investors to buy more bonds is becoming all too real. The result is that, despite having displayed a tough, anti-China stance during his campaign, Trump is actually putting the very survival of the dollar in China's hands. Further, the Trump administration is also walking away from its nationalist tone, as its tax plan will actually help Americans purchase more foreign goods and services. From a balanced, unbiased point of view, that in itself isn't bad. But from a nationalist point of view, it's blasphemy. By keeping Americans from paying more taxes, they will have more money to purchase products coming from abroad. Foreign companies and governments will then, as a result, have more capital to invest in U.S. Treasury bonds. To middle-of-the-road and establishment economists, this phenomenon known as a trade deficit is detrimental to Americans as domestic businesses aren't exporting as much as Americans are buying from abroad. Nationalists like Trump and his supporters also agree, as noted by the Washington Post. So it is surprising that the administration is now attempting to downplay the inevitable trade deficit increase by claiming instead that his tax plan will increase domestic investment, keeping the money within U.S. borders and eventually increasing exports. To anyone who truly understands how the economy works, the notion that trade deficits are damaging to the economy in any real sense is ludicrous. As Austrian economist Murray Rothbard noted, instead of crying because we're not exporting enough, we should rejoice that foreign investors are willing to finance our cheap imports. Even so, on the campaign trail, Trump accused his opponent, Hillary Clinton, of unleashing a trade war against the American worker by supporting trade deals that, in his view, benefited China and crushed the United States. Promising that the era of economic surrender would finally be over, he energized his nationalist base by promising to get America to export more than it imports again. Except now, he's supporting the trade deficit, which is a boogeyman to his base. Unfortunately, to the president's legacy, it will come back to bite him if this plan eventually makes its way to his desk. With a tax bill that both continues to give China incentives to help maintain the dollar's strength and increases the trade deficit, making America not that great again in the eyes of Trump's supporters, it's clear that the president and Republicans aren't being as consistent, or even as conservative, as they may have claimed in the past. Bubble dynamics and market crashes. To paraphrase one of the great gems of Wall Street wisdom, nothing infuriates a man more than the sight of other people making money. That's a pretty good description of what happens during the late stage of a stock market bubble. The bubble participants are making money every day. Meanwhile, the more patient, prudent investor is stuck on the sidelines allocated to cash or low-risk investments while watching everyone else have fun. This is especially true today when the bubble is not confined to the stock market, but includes exotic sideshows like cryptocurrencies and Chinese real estate. It gets even worse when investors are taunted by headlines like the one in a recent article, "Investors can either buy bubbles or be left far behind." The article is a case study in the publisher's portfolio. Infuriating indeed. Actually, it should not be. On a risk-adjusted basis, the prudent investor is not missing much. When markets go up 10%, 20% or more in short periods, market participants think of their gains as money in the bank. Yet, that's not true unless you sell and cash out of the market. Few do this because they're afraid to miss out on continued gains. The problem comes when the bubble bursts and losses of 30%, 40% or more pile up quickly. Investors tell themselves they'll be smart enough to get out in time, but that's not true either. Typically, investors don't believe the tape. They buy the dips, then they refuse to sell until they get back to even, which can take 10 years. These are predictable behaviors of real investors caught up in real bubbles. It's better just to diversify, build up a cash reserve, have some gold for catastrophe insurance, and then wait out the bubble crowd. When the crash comes, which it always does, you'll be well positioned to shop for high-quality bargains amid the rubble. Then you'll participate in the next long upswing without today's risks of a sudden meltdown. Okay, so I just argued that the stock market are in bubbles. But where's the actual proof for this? Actually, it's everywhere. The Shiller-Cape ratio is at levels only seen at the 1929 crash that started the Great Depression, and the 2000.com bubble. Likewise, the market capitalization to GDP ratio is above the level of the 2008 panic and comparable to the 1929 crash. The list goes on, including historically low volatility and unprecedented complacency on the part of investors. For almost a year, one of the most profitable trading strategies has been to sell volatility. That's about to change. Since the election of Donald Trump, stocks have been a one-way bet. They almost always go up, and have hit record highs day after day. The strategy of selling volatility has been so profitable that promoters tout it to investors as a source of steady, low-risk income. Nothing could be further from the truth. Yes, sellers of volatility have made steady profits the past year. But the strategy is extremely risky, and you could lose all of your profits in a single bad day. Think of this strategy as betting your life savings on red at a roulette table. If the wheel comes up red, you double your money. But if you keep playing, eventually the wheel will come up black and you'll lose everything. That's what it's like to sell volatility. It feels good for a while, but eventually a black swan appears, like the black number on the roulette wheel, and the sellers get wiped out. I focus on the shocks and unexpected events that others don't see. In short, we have been on a volatility holiday. Volatility is historically low and has remained so for an unusually long period of time. The sellers of volatility have been collecting steady income, yet this is really just a winning streak at the volatility casino. I expect the wheel of fortune to turn and for luck to run out for the sellers. But it's time to add another warning sign to the list. Certain high-yield indices have fallen below their 200-day moving average. This can be indicative of a stock market correction. Junk bonds are riskier than equity. When they get in trouble, it's a sign that the corporate issuers are having trouble meeting their obligations. That in turn is indicative of reduced revenues or profits, tight financial conditions, and lower earnings. Panics in October 1987 and December 1994 were preceded by distress in bonds about 6 months earlier. While there is no deterministic relationship, bonds are a good leading indicator of stocks because they are higher in the capital table and feel distress sooner. The October 1987 one-day 22% decline in stocks and the December 1994 tequila crisis in Mexican debt were ugly for investors. The bond market gave a 6 month early warning both times. It may be doing so again. But what the Fed? Is it setting markets up for a fall? It's true that the Fed has been raising interest rates since 2015 and had engaged in tapering for 2 years before that. Yet, these actions hardly constitute tight money. The tightness or ease of monetary policy needs to be judged relative to financial and economic conditions. You can have easy money at a 10% interest rate if inflation is running at 15%. In that world, the real interest rate is -5.0%. 10% minus 15% equals -5%. In effect, the bank pays you to borrow. That's easy money. By most models, including the famous Taylor rule, rates in the US today should be about 2.5% instead of 1.0%. We have easy money today and have had since 2006. This comes on top of the too low for too long policy of Alan Greenspan from 2002-04, which led directly to the housing bubble and collapse in 2007. The US really has not had a hard money period since the mid-1990s. That's true of most of the developed economies also. What's going to happen when central banks start to normalize interest rates and balance sheets and return to a true tight money policy in preparation for the next recession? We're about to find out. Central banks all over the world, including the Fed, ECB, and the People's Bank of China, are in the early stages of ending their decade-long easy money policies. This tightening trend has little to do with inflation and more to do with deflating asset bubbles and getting ready for a new downturn. But, in following this policy, central bankers may actually pop the bubbles and cause the downturn they are getting ready to cure. This is one more reason, in addition to those described above, why the stock market bubble is about to implode. It's important to realize that market crashes often happen not when everyone is worried about them, but when no one is worried about them. Complacency and overconfidence are good leading indicators of an overvalued market set for a correction or worse. The money is just sitting there, doing nothing for society. Of all the despicable side effects of modern monetary policy, the worst might be the implicit encouragement artificially low interest rates give small savers to take outsized risks. The only thing worse might be when government makes it explicit how Denmark is trying to get savers to invest in risky assets. In the country with the longest history of negative interest rates, an experiment is underway. The minister in charge of Denmark's finance industry wants savers to shift some of the billions of kroner now in bank deposits over to riskier assets. Danes have about 840 billion kroner in bank deposits, the latest central bank figures show. Nykredit, the biggest Danish mortgage bank, estimates that number will continue to grow through the end of 2017, marking a record. But those bank deposits pay no interest. Add the effect of inflation, and savers are actually losing money. For corporate clients, banks charge a fee to hold their deposits, making the loss even bigger. Business Minister Brian Michelsen says he doesn't want to force households into anything. But the money is just sitting there at zero interest doing nothing for society, he said in an interview. I'm hoping we can put some of all those billions to work. Denmark has had negative central bank rates for about half a decade, longer than any other country on the planet, to defend the krona's peg to the euro. Michelsen's proposal is intended to shift bank deposits into designated equity savings accounts. The idea is that doing so will support Danish companies and help savers earn a little more. The banks themselves believe they can put billions of this money to work as investments, Michelsen said. We need to see how the final proposal is drawn up, but that money's free, so why not put it to work through an equity savings account? Michelsen this month won political backing for his plan, which would take effect in 2019. Danes will be allowed to place up to 200,000 kroner into the equity savings accounts. Returns will be subject to a 17% tax, which is less than half Denmark's capital gains tax. The plan also envisages that savers can get tax rebates on investments as big as 800,000 kroner in startups. According to Nordea Bank AB, Scandinavia's biggest financial group, Denmark faces negative interest rates until well into 2020. So the world's governments screw up their country's finances by borrowing too much and, in order to afford the interest on their debts, pushing interest rates down to zero. Then they tell savers who are just trying to put something away for life's exigencies that their bank accounts aren't helping society, and encourage those people to take risks with their meager nest eggs. Not so long ago, even politicians understood that savings were the engine of the economy. People stored their extra money in banks, which then lent that money out, often to those same customers, to start businesses and buy houses. Now governments are asking small savers to bail them out by buying growth stocks, at the peak of a multi-year bull market that's due to end with a bang fairly shortly. Interesting that governments aren't saying increase domestic investment, keeping the money within US borders, and eventually increasing exports. To anyone who truly understands how the economy works, the notion that trade deficits are damaging to the economy in any real sense is ludicrous. As Austrian economist Murray Rothbard noted, instead of crying because we're not exporting enough, we should rejoice that foreign investors are willing to finance our cheap imports. Even so, on the campaign trail, Trump accused his opponent, Hillary Clinton, of unleashing a trade war against the American worker by supporting trade deals that, in his view, benefited China and crushed the United States. Promising that the era of economic surrender would finally be over, he energized his nationalist base by promising to have to make ends meet by issuing additional bonds. According to the Street, Louis Federal Reserve, there are more foreign banks, corporations, and investors who hold U.S. Treasury bonds than private domestic investors. And to Trump's likely horror, over a third of the foreign investors are from China and Japan, meaning that in combination with Hong Kong, China held $1.38 trillion in bonds in September, making it the country's largest foreign creditor. To nations like China, purchasing U.S. Treasury bonds makes sense because the dollar still holds its position as the world's main reserve currency. By purchasing Treasury bonds and notes, foreign investors actually help the United States government delay with the dollar's eventual collapse, as the bonds help to maintain the dollar's value even as the services. From a balanced, unbiased point of view, that in itself isn't bad. But from a nationalist point of view, it's blasphemy. By keeping Americans from paying more taxes, they will have more money to purchase products coming from abroad. Foreign companies and governments will then, as a result, have more capital to invest in U.S. Treasury bonds. To middle-of-the-road and establishment economists, this phenomenon known as a trade deficit is detrimental to Americans as domestic businesses aren't exporting as much as Americans are buying from abroad. Nationalists like Trump and his supporters also agree, as noted by the Washington Post. So it is surprising that the administration is now attempting to downplay the inevitable trade deficit increase by claiming instead that his tax plan will about Trump's tax plan. Washington Republicans want to lower Americans' taxes without bringing spending down, and President Donald Trump appears to be completely on board with this plan despite having complained about the same practice in the past. But this policy has a series of other unintended consequences. One of them, as the Washington Post's Wang blog explains, is that Trump's tax plan will give China even more power over the U.S. economy, as additional treasury bonds will have to be issued for decades to come to cover for the tax cuts. Since less revenue will come in from taxpayers, the U.S. will have a gap to fill, and the government, the Federal Reserve has, until very recently, has continued to increase the money supply, bringing the overall purchasing power of the dollar down because its supply is much higher than what the market demands. This has been true ever since President Richard Nixon destroyed the dollar by bringing an end to the gold standard. With the Trump administration's support, Congress is raising the debt as they also cut revenue, read, taxation, and the necessity to press investors to buy more bonds is becoming all too real. The result is that, despite having displayed a tough, anti-China stance during his campaign, Trump is actually putting the very survival of the dollar in China's hands. Further, the Trump administration is also walking away from its nationalist tone, as its tax plan will actually help Americans purchase more foreign goods and